Welcome to the Know Your Legacy podcast. I'm your host, Philippa Bassania, and today's guest is Preston Smiles. Preston is a motivational messenger, author, coach, speaker, and living legend. He's teaching people how to love bigger, love better, and love louder to live their best lives now. This is a long time coming, over a year we've been trying to make this happen. So Preston, thank you so much for being here.
Let's do it, my man. I'm super grateful to be on the podcast. To be in the vortex and to be connecting with you and all the beautiful humans who've been attracted to your light.
Most definitely. Absolutely. I appreciate you, man. So first off, before we get into all the things that you're doing now and, you know, everything that you've got going on, because there's so much, I think there's so many layers to your story. So I guess the first place to start is, what does your name mean, Preston, and how did you get Smiles?
My government name, or back in the day, I used to say my slave name, because essentially that's what it is. It's some white dude who raped my great-great-great-great-grandmother and said, this is now your new name, is Davis. However, about 2005, so how many years ago would that be?
14 years ago.
14 years. Good at math. There we go. So about 14 years ago, I was in graduate school, getting a master's degree, and there used to be this janitor who would mop the floors and clean the bathrooms and all of that stuff, and all the kids would like smoke their cigarettes in front of her and flick them on the ground, and then she would go pick them up, and it always bothered me. I would always be like, why are you guys doing that? It's super disrespectful. So instead of just fighting them all the time, I began to befriend her. And what we would do is I think it was Tuesday, Thursday, and Fridays, I had class at 8 a.m. But I would show up at 7 a.m. with a bottle of water, because this was in Louisiana, it was really hot, cold bottle of water, and a granola bar for her and myself. And we would have breakfast. So she would put her mop down and all her stuff, and we would sit in the hallway, nobody's there, and we'd just talk. I'd get to know her. Her name was Miss Evans. And one day, maybe 5-6 months later, I'm running down the hall and I'm doing whatever I'm doing. And she stops me and she says, boy, you always run around here smiling. I'm gonna call you Preston Smiles with your happy self. And it was one of those moments where I didn't take it on as my name at that moment, but it landed for me. It was like, That feels more in alignment than Davis. And so when I moved to LA and I became an actor and all that stuff, I was still Preston Davis. And there was a point where I said, you know what? It's time for me to do what's really on my heart and step into the work of transformation and personal development and really allow myself to go there. And I want to do it from who I believe I really am versus what I was sold. And so I chose Preston Smiles based on that Miss Evans giving me that name.
Yeah, that's an amazing story. How old were you at that time?
I was 23 or 24 when she gave me that, when she said that to me.
Okay, yeah. Just before we go on real quick, is that a mic on your headphones?
It is.
Okay, I don't know if it's on because your voice is like scattered everywhere. So I don't know if it's on. You want to check real quick?
Yeah. Pause. Let me know.
Cool. Yeah. So you were about 21 at that time. So if we just peel back the layers a bit more, what memories come up for you when you think of your childhood?
Quite a few, man. It's one of those things where my childhood was awesome in the sense where I didn't have rules. I played outside all day, all night. I grew up in California, in LA, and so I didn't have rules. And so most of my time was spent like hopping fences and busting windows and like stealing from liquor stores and stuff like that. I also, you know, had some of my friends get shot and killed based on some of the things that we were doing. And that wasn't awesome at the time for sure. And when I was very early, I was put in special education, brought to a classroom that had about three or four mentally ill children. And I don't mean that from any disrespect, but they were literally like drooling on themselves. And so in my 7-8-year-old mind, I made up a story that I was like them. If I'm in class with these kids that are playing with blocks and drooling on themselves, then I must be like them. I must be stupid. I must be less than. And so I began to develop this deep shame about, you know, whether I was good enough or smart enough. And so if I couldn't do it that way, then I would dominate in sports and I would beat up the bullies and befriend the nerds. And so I became like this sort of Robin Hood in elementary school. And all the people who were getting bullied or had things wrong with them, like, you know, like I remember this kid had one of his legs was shorter and people would make fun of him. And I was like the best athlete and I was like fast and strong and all of that stuff. And so when they would make fun of him, I would go after the people who made fun of him. And so all the like kids who, you know, were smaller or called faggots and things like that, I would have their back. And because I had their back, they would like help me with school and stuff like that. So my childhood was pretty trippy, man. Like, I'm grateful for it because it gives me the opportunity to do the work that I do now. Like I can go deeper than most coaches can even possibly think about. I deal with some of the worst stuff you could put into somebody's space, and it doesn't scare me. It doesn't shake me. Like I know what to do because I've been down so many deep rabbit holes and I've been in this work for 11 years now. Yeah, it's a Pandora's box if you want to go in there.
Yeah, so it's I guess all of that stuff helps you go to a more compassionate and empathetic place when you're dealing with the people that you're dealing with now. I mean, so what was your relationship like with your parents at the time? Like, was your mom and dad around? Like, what was it like with them, like, around those school days?
Yeah, man, it was. But like many of us, my dad spent dad and mom both worked. And so I didn't spend that much time with them. And when I did, you know, it was sort of like militaristic in some ways. Like they believed in this sort of Christian ideology that spare the rod, spare the child. And so I feared my parents. And so even as a little boy, my mom, you know, had a conversation, and a lot of little boys, a lot of men have this issue. Their mothers didn't like certain aspects of the masculine, or didn't like certain aspects of their dad or their grandfather or the guys that cheated on them when they were 12 or 15. And so what they did was they raised a bunch of little boys to be the opposite of what they disliked. And so my mother tried to create this perfect gentleman out of me. And out of that, I began to believe that it was like when women are around, I was on duty. I couldn't be myself when women were around because I needed to be a gentleman and take care of everybody and make sure everybody else's needs were met before my own. And so this people-pleasing sort of good, nice guy was born out of that. And I've been able to, over the last 11 years, just break all that bullshit down and step into my king and my warrior in a way in which it creates space and a container for other men to do the same. And so my work in Man Cave and Conscious Man Brotherhood is a part of that.
So just to stop real quick then, for those who are listening right now and could relate to that sort of personality type or archetype, what were the sorts of things you would talk to them about or tell them when it comes to breaking out of that mindset of people pleasing and I have to put other people first?
Yeah. Well, we start with awareness, right? Because awareness comes before choice. You know, the awareness of when you're doing it is a win in itself. So I would start with just like catch how many times a day you put someone else's needs ahead of yours. Catch how many times a day you hide or, you know, do things behind the scenes because you're afraid you'll be judged. Catch how many times a day you catch that you're actually doing a job or chasing some career that you don't really want, or in college because your parents want you to be there, not because you actually want to be there. Right? This is the awareness in itself is a win. The moment you have awareness, you can do something about it. And then when you do catch it, play with what it would look like. to own your power in that moment and say no. Do the opposite, right? You just play the opposite game. If you always go left, try right. If you always go right, try left. See what happens. You know, my work is all about trying things on. We can go super deep into childhood wounds and traumas and things of that nature, but the only way to ever break through something is to actually get into action and see what shows up in the game. We can sit in the sidelines and we could talk about LeBron and we can talk about, you know, the baseball players or whoever, but until we're in the game, we don't know what we're made of. And so I invite men and women to step to their edge and go too far. I'm the go too far guy. Go past what's comfortable.
I love that. I love that. So I'm not sure if you're familiar with Sadhguru's work. He's like Eastern Mystic. Yeah. So I can tell from information. So I was watching a video the other day. My brother sent it, and someone in the audience asked him, "How do I know what the right thing to do is in marriage, life, relationships?" And he said exactly the same as you. He was like, "All in all, his general premise was you need to be involved in life. Life is about involvement. Like you need you." It's, you could talk about these theories and this premises, these ideas of, oh, what if that, what if this? But until you do it, nothing has happened. You haven't done anything in your physical, you know, nature or presence. So you've got to step in and push the boundaries and see. And if it doesn't, if left doesn't sit right, then you've taken that journey and now you know right, you know, and you could tell the story of what it was like to go left. So you have to just be like, you have to play around a bit. So just to ground it down a bit for people listening, can you give an example of where you might have done some people-pleasing stuff that you remember and then what you did to do the opposite?
Absolutely. You know, it happens quite often, to tell you the truth. You know, you'll be given lots of opportunity for the rest of your life to people-please. You know, it can be as simple as ordering something, like you're drinking a coffee right now or something to drink, right? You order something and they give you the wrong thing, but there's a part of you that doesn't want to rock the boat, doesn't want to cause a fuss. Oh, it's no big deal. They gave me coconut milk instead of almond milk. It's all good. Is it though? Right? Like just playing with, for me, I do that everywhere. I play with and lean into ownership. What do I really want? Right? Sometimes you have to go way, way past what is comfortable in order to find your way back to the middle. And in reality, there is no middle. We're always going in either direction. This idea of balance is actually BS. I don't believe in balance at all. Nothing on the planet is balanced. It's always moving, changing, and shifting. And so if we let go of the idea that I'm finally going to land and everything's going to be in balance and everything's going to be perfect, it's the moment you let that go and just get in the game and enjoy the ride, enjoy the journey, the whole thing opens up. My wife and I have moments all the time where we're negotiating what's what. You know, we had something come up with somebody who I believe betrayed me. And I had to say to her and to him, I no longer want to be this person's friend. And if you choose to be his friend, all good. You can do that. That's your choice as an autonomous being. However, I will not be this person's friend. This no longer serves me, nor him, nor us. So I'm stepping out. The people pleaser in me wanted to go, well, let's just make it all okay. Let's make sure everybody's happy. Let's make sure that he feels really good right now. And I don't care, right? Because the medicine that he came to get may be inside of the discomfort of betraying a friend. Do you understand what I'm saying? The medicine that he may need to get is wrapped inside of me, not people-pleasing and saying, no, here's my boundary. You crossed it. Now we are no longer friends. And I don't feel the need to try to make you feel good about you crossing the boundary.
Yeah. No, that makes sense. So it's almost, am I right in saying it's coming from a place of self-love? Like I respect myself enough to not allow this to continue.
For sure.
So just to resume on the timeline of things. So you're like 12, 13, and you're doing what you're doing in school, as an athlete, as an individual who's protecting others who are suffering or going through pain. What happens next leading up to, do you go to college, university? What goes on around that time?
Yeah, so 13, I'm in a gang at this point. I'm smoking weed. I started smoking weed at 11. My dad caught me at 11, and he told me it was okay. and that for me to look at all the other people in the neighborhood that I knew who smoked weed and ask myself, did I want their life? And he said, we'll talk about it tomorrow. So he gave me some time to reflect. And so the next day I'm thinking I'm going to get in trouble. And we sit down and I say, you know what? I looked at everybody's life who smokes weed and I think that I don't want that life. So I'm not going to do it anymore. And he says, perfect. He's like, it's from the earth. I have no problems with it. But I also know that you're a leader. And you're such a leader that when everybody else is going left, if something inside of you says go right, do it. And make mistakes. I'm not going to stop you from doing those things. I'm going to trust that your leadership will show up in those moments. And I'm telling you that because we're going to fast forward to now 15 years old. I'm in a gang and I'm hanging out with these guys. One of them, his name is Scott. He's a really cool kid. Scott and Rudy and Emmanuel and I used to go to these liquor stores and grab alcohol at 15, 16, and 17 and run out and steal the alcohol. And so one particular night, Scott called me and he was like, you know, yo, you coming out? We're going to pick you up in like an hour. And I said, nah, man, I think I'm going to chill tonight. And the reason why I said that is because intuition told me not to go. This is the first time. I'm 15. First time I have intuition hit me so hard. So I say, nah, I think I'm going to chill. And he's like, what? You're going to be a beep? I'm like, yeah, I'm going to be a beep tonight. Like, you guys go. And he's like, all right, cool. We'll catch you tomorrow. So he hangs up the phone. Within an hour, every single person in that blue Astro van that I was in the night before and the night before that and the night before that was shot. And Scott, my best friend, the person who I would fight over the front seat for, was shot in the head and died immediately. Now, I went into complete shock when I found this out. I actually found out the next day. I was at a basketball game, and I went into complete shock and just collapsed. And then we drove to his house, and his mom, as we turned around the corner, we could hear his mom screaming, my baby, not my baby. And so my mom got out of the car, ran in, hugged her. And I just didn't even know what to do. I didn't even know how to cry. I was just in shock. And so I talked to my dad and I said, listen, I got to get out of here. I'm afraid for my life. And he said, okay, where do you want to go? And I said, anywhere. So he sent me to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. To his high school sweetheart, to a woman named Shirley Russell. And this is before the internet. This is before cell phones. So I got off a plane and there was a sign with my name on it. And it was this woman, Shirley. And she took me and we had never laid eyes on each other. I'd never seen her in person. There was no cell phone pictures or anything like that. So I got off, I see the sign, I see the woman, her name's Shirley. She says, hi, I'm Shirley. I move in with her. She becomes my new mother. She actually sat next to my mother when I was getting married a few years ago. And she took me in. And Shirley lived within North Allegheny County, which was one of the richest counties in the United States at that point. And so we went to school that first day. And take in mind, the school I came from didn't have books. The people would light the lockers on fire. It was like really messed up. It was like a really jacked up school. And so I pull up to this new school and there's Mercedes and BMWs and just rich kids everywhere, turf football fields, state-of-the-art, like, you know, TVs and like you could eat off the ground. And I'm like in complete shock again. And so I'm walking through the hallways and everybody starts, you know, in the classrooms who are sitting in class, they have these windows that you can see out of and people are looking through the windows as I'm walking by each class. And they're like getting up and they're like tapping each other like, oh, and I can see them talking about me as I'm walking past each classroom. So I get to the office and the woman sits me down. She says, okay, you're going to be in this class, and this class. I heard you play basketball. You're probably going to join the basketball team, et cetera, et cetera. She said, do you have any questions for me before I send you to class? And I said, well, yeah, I have one question. She said, yeah. It's like, you know, is there anybody else at this school who maybe looks like me? And she said, oh, black? No, there's no black people here. You're the only black person at the whole school. And I literally lost it. Hold on. One second. I literally lost it. It was so cool because I instantly became the most popular person in school just because I was the only person of color in the school. And so I within a few weeks joined a new game called Wexford Mafia. It's a bunch of rich white kids. And we're in this kid, Brad's BMW, headed to a party. And I'll never forget this because it's changed my life forever. We're headed to a party. We're in the BMW. We're listening to Outkast, Wheels of Steel, right? So there's the wheels of steel, right? And everybody's drinking and smoking weed. I am drinking. I have a 40 in my hand, like a 40-ounce of beer. And we're drinking and driving. This kid, Brad, has his seat. This is back in the day when you used to wait, put your seat all the way back in the lap of the next person. And so his seat was basically sitting in my lap. And everybody, he's like smoking weed and acting cool and drinking. And we're headed to this party. And I have this realization that the kids at my former school were doing the same exact thing, but getting two different results based on the environment. I really caught that, you know, the kids at my former school were going to jail and the kids at this school who happened to be white were going to Yale. But we were all bombarded by the same media. We were all experiencing the same stuff, but yet and still the way the environment was set up, it was one that, this is just the phase for you guys and you're gonna die for you guys. And it opened my space and my life up just enough for me to understand that love is really all there is. That underneath all of the stories that we have about each other, whether it be gay, straight, white, black, Christian, Muslim, Indian, African American, whatever you want to call it, underneath all of that is love, pure, unadulterated love. All of it is love. And so, of course, it got too cold and now I couldn't last in those winters. And so, went back to California and then ended up barely getting into college. And I can stop there for right now, but like that's some of the story.
Yeah, that's crazy so far. I mean, your dad sounds like a smart guy for giving you that advice, because it seems like that's what he turned you on to, understanding that feeling when it finally hit you. That was the time it was going to change everything for you. So what did your dad do in terms of what was he doing? Yeah.
As far as what he does for work or what was he doing?
Yeah, no, what he does for work.
My dad actually is an interesting character because he's like this interesting conundrum. If you met him, you'd be tripped out by him. Because my dad has been a drug dealer. My dad has been someone who, you know, openly has said to me many times, your mom's a bitch, your sister's a bitch, all women are bitches. And yet and still, my dad is the person who taught me that everybody deserves respect, that, you know, you treat the janitor the same way you treat the president of the company. My dad's the same person who, you know, would blast Bob Marley while we're driving down the street singing, could you be love, and just kiss me and hug me. And he was at every basketball game, every football game. He was at every practice. He would drive us to the skating rink. My dad was really involved in my life. And yet he had his shadow side that was really, really blaring. And so my dad taught me so much in just who he was being and who he, the ways in which we clashed. He got laid off from Hughes Aircraft really early and decided he would never work for the man, and I'm doing quotes here, ever again. And so my dad is retired. I pay for everything, actually. Like, not everything, but a lot. And it's a gift that I'm able to do so. You know, I've been blessed and hustled my face off to financially be in a position where I can pay my mom's mortgage and my dad's and as many people in my family as I can. You know?
Yeah, it's an amazing gift that he's given you, just to understand what that feeling is in a GPS, you know, for your life to direct you every step of the way. Is that the biggest lesson you took away from it?
I'd say so. You know, that and just how loving and touchy my whole family is. My dad was very, like, I can remember being, you know, 14, 15, 16 years old, and my dad's still kissing me on the lips, you know? And, like, I didn't think it was weird until my friends thought it was weird. you know? It was one of those things where he'd like kiss me, be like, I love you. And like, my friends were like, bro, should dad just kiss you? Like, yeah. Like, that's gay. Like, is it?
Yeah. It says a lot about the shape of our beliefs, you know, like the opinions of others. Straight away they pierce us and they're like, well, crap, maybe that is weird. Maybe I should stop doing that. And then you exactly. And then you live in this boundary. And as I'm talking, the one of the things that you brought up in a different conversational video was the report or the research done with the fleas.
Yes.
And it brings me to that. And I, if you could just share that with people, for those who may be listening to it for the first time, because I think that's truly profound. And yeah, say that first. And then I've got another question to ask you from what you've learned from there.
Absolutely. So there was a scientific experiment done with fleas, where they would place them in a jar. And the fleas, for the first couple days, first 3 or 4 days, the fleas would jump up and hit the top of the lid of the jar and try to escape. But then what would happen after the third or fourth day is they would all jump, but they would jump just high enough to not hit the top of the lid. Then on like the fifth or sixth day, they would take the lid off, but the fleas would never, ever jump out of that jar. They would literally die and starve to death inside of that jar, because even though the lid was no longer on there, they had already had a fixed belief that that's as far as they could go. And when I was sharing that video on my social media, I was tying in that so many of us unconsciously are living out those same patterns that we learned from our parents. Like we are like, you know, I'll tell you a short story, and this is me not showing off. This is me, or not me trying to impress, but me trying to impress upon you that anybody, if I can, anybody can. I come from special education. I come from gangs, and I'm a millionaire, bro. And I'm going to show you something. So when I was, I've been in the game for 11 years, right? And even before I was in this work, I was an actor and a model. I was on Entourage and a bunch of other stuff and Levi's campaigns and all this other stuff, right? And all my life, I could never make more than $60,000, like the whole time. At 33 years old, I decided to move in with my mother, take a few steps back, invest the money that I was using for rent, for coaching, mentorship, support, masterminds, anything I could get my hands on where somebody could hold me accountable. And I learned and leaned in and found my edges and broke the family lineages of never enough and the money scarcity mindset that my mother and father both had, and their mother and father both had, and their mother and father both had. And I leaned in, never making more than 60K. 33 years old, I'm moving with my mom. That end of the year, I made 150,000. The next year, 300. The next year, 600. The next year, 1 million. The next year, and we're now here, right? We just wrapped up 2018, somewhere around 2. Like, and I'm not gonna stop. So what is that, right? All those years, I'm a flea in the jar, only making it so far. The lid is off. I could jump out all those years, never making more than 60,000. As soon as I make a decision and get support. Now catch what happened. I got support. I didn't do it by myself. A lot of people listening to this podcast right now think that podcasts and books are enough. They're not. I get it. They are helpful. They're not enough though. You need accountability, you need support, you need coaching, you need mentorship, you need somebody who can see what you can't. You need somebody to talk back to you. A book can't talk back to you. A podcast can't talk back to you. You need somebody to say, bullshit, you're hiding. Lean in again, go again. You need somebody to say, you just fail. Get back up, I got you, I love you, I see you, right? I did that and it broke through. And I've now jumped through that jar to the point where my kid and their kids will never be in that fucking jar again. Now that's work. That's how you do it. And everybody has their own version of that. So if I can, you can.
Yeah, I love that so much. I'm so glad you shared that, and with that level of passion, because there's as you were talking, I was remembering something that Deepak Chopra said, and he was saying that exactly the same as you, it gets passed on in the genes, the action, the emotion, all gets passed on. And Mastin Kip, I had him on the episode on the podcast not too long ago, and we were talking about something that Carl Jung said, which really just blew my mind, which was the biggest stressor that kids can have is the unlived lives of the parents.
Yes.
Until I started thinking about that, I was like, yeah, hang on, because the trauma that they have and the limited mindset and scarcity that they have in their actions, behaviors, emotions, relationships, yes, money, all gets passed down because that's how they raise you. They don't know how else to raise you. So, and that, and then Deepak Chopra was talking about cows in a farm. And if they put an electric fence on the fence, the cows won't go near it after they get stung once or twice.
Yep.
And what happens is every generation, for seven generations after that, they intuitively know not to go near the fence.
Yep.
That's crazy. 100%. And so I was going to ask you, from everything that you were doing, one, what were one of the key things that you did during that transition period of mentorship and understanding and learning and growing your consciousness that really helped you leap for those who are listening who are stuck? And then what are you doing to ensure that Kingston isn't in the jar?
Yes, absolutely. So I'm going to go backwards. I'm going to start with the latter. One of the best things anybody could ever do for themselves is to not believe that you're done. A lot of people enter personal development so that they can figure it out and finally be done with having to deal with their own shadows and insecurities and unworthiness. For me, how I will ensure that Kingston gets everything he needs is by understanding I will never land. That as long as there is breath in my body, there's more work to lean into. And I can do it with a smile on my face and my heart. A lot of people think that the work means that you need to be, you know, serious and crying and, you know, catharting and all of that stuff. Some of the greatest work, you know, what I have some of my clients do all the time? I did it for a year straight and I still do it to this day. I schedule in play. You know how hard it is for people to have joy on a day-to-day basis, to actually take time out to just play and do something fun for themselves? You know what I mean? People do not do that. That in itself would change your life. Why? Because you cannot have what you want, but you may experience what you have. I'm going to say that one more time. You cannot have what you want, but you may experience what you have. That is a game changer, period. And when I got that, when I got that I'm a vibrational being and that everything... When I choose to lean into the bigness of myself, meaning the bigness of God, the bigness of creation, and enjoy that bigness, that I become a vibrational match for everything that also swims at that frequency, then everything shifted, right? There, we talk about in business, vibrational marketing. Like, I don't have to look for clients. I literally have people knocking down my door. The video you sent me, I did not go after you to find this podcast. I know people looking, I want to be interviewed. I want to be interviewed. Oh, you have somebody? I never have to look. I've been interviewed on the biggest podcast in the world, and I never have to look. Why? Because vibrationally, I'm in alignment. Not all the time, definitely in the work, definitely find myself deep in low vibrations, but I don't stay there. I don't live there because I know that that's not my truth. The truth is that I'm a unique emanation of the Most High, just like you. The truth is that love is all there is, was, and ever will be, just like you, just like me. Right? And so I remember that constantly. I hope that answers your question.
It does, most definitely. And for those who are looking to take it to the next level and they are where you used to be, which is low vibration, and they're lost, no purpose, depressed, whatever label you want to put on it, put on it. How do they come out of low vibration to start going towards higher vibration? Was there, in that transition period, was there daily activity you were doing, visualizing, and writing things down? Let's break it down for people.
Okay, so this is how it works. I'm going to give you a metaphor or is this an analogy? It's one or the other. You tell me. So you're in a desert and you're hot, you're starving, and off in the distance you see a tree, and the tree has all this, and you, as you begin to approach the tree, you see that there's all this beautiful fruit and some of the juiciest mangoes and like apples and oranges are all at the top of the tree. But there's also some fruit right where you can reach it. So what I teach people and what I did for myself and I do for myself whenever I find myself way down in the dumps is I reach for low hanging fruit, i.e. meaning I reach for that which I know will bring my vibration up just a little bit more. Because as soon as I get that first bite of the fruit, even if it's not the best fruit, it's going to give me the strength and the vitality and the energy to reach for the next branch. And then when I get to that branch, I'll take another bite. Got some more energy. I'll go a little higher and a little higher. And all of a sudden, I find myself at the top of that damn tree. Everybody's trying to jump from starving to death to the best fruit at the top. And that usually doesn't work. It's little by little, step by step. So you ask yourself, what makes my heart smile? Is it going to the movies? One of my favorite movies is Coming to America. And so I'll watch that, I'll die, right? One of my favorite things that will change my life anywhere I am is getting in nature. Take my shoes off, get in the nature. Go swimming, get in the ocean. Go running through the woods, right? This is low-hanging fruit. There's a video on YouTube of newscasters messing up and laughing. It's like a 13-minute video. That video, every single time I watch it, has me in tears laughing. That's low-hanging fruit. I don't even have to go anywhere to get that fruit. I just open up YouTube. This is what people have to do. Does that make sense?
Most definitely does. So I think people are so busy these days, they just don't see the need to play. Like, why? I don't have time. You know, that's the number one excuse. Is that what people you find tell you a lot as well?
Yes. And I say, well, then you don't have time for life. Because the last thing you want to do is get to the top of that mountain and realize that you weren't present for any of the journey, right? Because it'll just be another mountain. We've heard it a million times. We've seen it a million times. You're bullshitting yourself if you think that it's about landing and getting this money or getting this job or getting this girl or getting this man. Like, bullshit. Once you get the relationship, there's much more work. Once you get the job, you still got to keep the job. Once you make the money, you got to figure out how to make it again. So if you're not going to enjoy that process, then you've literally missed the point of life.
Life is the process. Like, yes, that's all there is. You have to just enjoy it, because I know it's been thrown out in quotes and videos in terms of the journey and not the destination, but the destination is a thing. It's an event. Yeah. The journey is the happening, the day to day, moment to moment, which you're in now. So mm-hmm. you can't waste. It's like you're wasting 23 hours just to experience the 24th hour, and then you're going to be unhappy. You've got 24 yes. hours to be happy. Why don't you just do that?
Yeah, exactly.
It makes sense. So now you're coming up to, I think, going back on the timeline, you're at university, I think, coming up to college, that age, like 21, 22, when the Preston Smiles or the Smiles name happens and you yeah. encounter that woman. What's life like for you then? Are you still involved in gangs, and what you study?
No. At that point, when I came back to LA after my friend got killed, I was completely out of that kind of thinking. But what I was still carrying that I didn't even realize until I was 27 was I cheated. I cheated. Every test I did in college, I cheated. Because I still was carrying the belief of the 7-year-old who was less than. I was in special education. So even though I was in college, I had this imposter syndrome. I had this fear that people would figure me out. They would finally find out that I'm stupid and not as smart as them. And so I was carrying that. And I'm sharing this because a lot of humans right now are carrying wounds that happened when they were 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Somebody called you a faggot when you were 7 years old, and you're still being macho to this day because you don't want to appear to be X, Y, and Z. Your parents were super stressed out, so you became this out of the way, sort of low maintenance kid, and you're still living this out right now. Your parents were super sad, and so you became the cheerer upper, always happy, positive one, and you're still living that to this day, and it's a prison. It's a prison. Everybody, it's not everybody, a lot of people are wearing masks that they don't know they're wearing. And so for me, I realized that I had cheated my way through college in undergrad, and so I got into graduate school, and I told myself I wouldn't cheat, not one day. I just wanted to see what I was made of. And so I got straight A's without cheating ever. And I was one of three people in my graduate class to do 4.0 across the board. And it made me realize that I was really intelligent. I just didn't have a standardized brain. So standardized tests didn't work well for me because I didn't have a standardized brain. As you can tell right now, yes, I'm dyslexic and I maybe don't read as fast as you or most of your listeners. However, I'm deeply intelligent, and the interpersonal skills and the understanding of the human condition, not to toot my own horn, but I'm really good at this, right? Like extremely, to the point where I feel like I could coach Tony Robbins easily. I could coach some of the best in the business easily and hold space for them. Because I've been in the in-between spaces. And so back to it. I graduate from college. I get out. I move to LA. I become this Abercrombie sort of model thing where I don't know if you know what store that is, but they have these guys who stand out in the front and they pay them extra money to have their shirts off and stuff like that. So I get all buff and I'm doing that. And they actually fired me because I was too happy. They wanted me to be what they said was sexy and
the serious look.
Yeah, yeah. And I was like high-fiving all the Asian tourists and just stupid stuff. I'm modeling, I'm acting, and all the while there's this thing on my heart. And I mean that literally and metaphorically. Because I began to feel these palpitations, like really weird heart things. And I had stayed away from doctors my whole life, but it got bad. So I went to see a doctor and she said, you need to see a cardiologist immediately. I went to see the cardiologist. He ran some tests. I came back a few days later. He said, your grandmother died of a heart disease. Your great grandmother died of heart disease. Your dad has a weak heart. You need to get a grip on this. Tell me about your life. And I told him about my life. And he said, you're really stressed out. And he said, tell me what you eat. And I said, I eat food. And he said, tell me about food. And I said, well, I eat McDonald's, Burger King. I drink beer, a bunch of cheese, sloppy Joe's, chicken every day, just fast food, you know? And he said, that's not food. I was like, what? Of course it's food. It's on the commercials. Everybody eats it. My mom eats it. My dad eats it. Everybody I know eats it. I've been eating this way my whole life, literally whole life, like the entire thing. And he said, as a doctor, I'm going to give you some pills that will regulate your heartbeat and you'll take these for the rest of your life. But as a dad and a concerned citizen, I suggest you look at this. And so I was devastated. Because I didn't want to die. You know, you can mess with everything else, but you mess with that heart and you're gone. I went back home. I told my girlfriend at the time and she told her mother. And her mother came to me and said, Preston, I just got this book by Jerry and Esther Hicks called Ask and It Is Given. And I know you don't read, but I think this would really be helpful for you. And I said, sure. I'll read it. I'll do anything at this point. So I open the book and I get to maybe three pages in and it says, your thoughts become things and you create your own reality. And I literally drop the book because I'm 25 years old and I've never heard those words ever in my life. I'm literally thinking to myself, how is this possible that I have a master's degree and nobody has ever said that to me? How is it possible that I've never, ever seen this? So I picked the book back up and I voraciously reading it, taking it, ingesting it. And then I go, well, what else have they lied about? And I watched this movie called Zeitgeist, which is what you would call maybe a conspiracy theory movie for some people. And that got me really upset. And then I became an angry vegan, and I denounced my religion, and I tried to convert my whole family into juicing, and all this stuff. And everybody, of course, was like, this dude's crazy. And then I realized, I had a huge realization, using the Buddha quote, you will not be punished for your anger, but by it. I realized that I was still, my skin was getting better, my life was getting better to a degree, but I was still so angry. I was angry at the government. I was angry at my parents. I was angry at all of life for being in this scenario. And then I realized that this was actually love, that this was a gift, that I was being used, that out of all my friends who got shot or went to jail, I have friends in jail right now. I sent money to jail a few months ago to some of my friends who have been there for years. And here I am, a millionaire, traveling the world, a wife, a kid, doing anything I want. I began to look around my life, and this is before all of that happened, but I was still broke as crap at this point, but I still realized that I was so taken care of, and that it wasn't a mistake that all of this was happening at this point. And so I began to use it, and I said, you know, I'm gonna learn everything I possibly can. I'm gonna take every workshop I can get my hands on. And people in the industry were like, yo, Preston's like a black Buddha. Like, you got to go get coaching from this dude. And so I didn't even know what coaching was at that point. I was more like counseling and holding space. And there was a point where I realized that everybody was asking the same questions. And so I said, I'm going to create a YouTube channel called Questions with Preston and just answer these so I can point to them instead of people coming to my house. And that was the beginning of my journey, bro. That like started everything. And here I am now.
I love that, man. Yeah, it's all a journey, as we were just talking about the other day, like enjoying that whole process, because eventually you were going to end up here. As long as you stay true to it and you just continued finding the next step and the next step and the next step and kept the courage, yes, the next step will be shown to you naturally, you know?
Yes.
So what point in that timeline do you meet Alexi? How does that happen?
Pretty later on. I met her in 2013. I met her right when I moved in with my mom. So I met her, I think, in November, and in December I was living with my mom. So it's crazy because she had all these rich guys who were like wanting to marry her, and she chose this guy who was like 33 living with his mom. We did the damn thing, and we're in the dance, and I love that woman with everything I have, man. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing to have a partner to be in the work with, and to reflect and trigger you and love on you and all that stuff, man. It's been absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, no, that's amazing, man. Just before we get into the last few questions, how do you know that she's the one? Or for the women that are listening, how do they know that the male person is the one?
You know, it's one of those things where it's going to be outside of anything you've ever experienced before. Right? And it doesn't mean that it happens instantly. For me, it did, but it doesn't always happen that way for most people. But it'll creep up on you. And it'll be one of those things where you're like, huh, this feels different. This feels like, and here's the thing, everybody is the one. Like, Vipul, you're the one in this moment because I'm present with you, right? So there's the one, and then there's the one romantically. And the thing is like, if you trust that God has never made a mistake and that the fundamental order of the universe is always harmony, right? So we talk about the chaos theory. If you pull far enough back, you'll see that there's order to the entire thing. I trust that. And so, and I challenge you to trust it as well. Whoever's with you, whoever you're being with, is, if they're not your one, they're your two, they're your three, or they're your seven. And whatever they are in that process, they are important keys and pieces to the puzzle called your journey. And so being present with people, giving them all of your heart, being integrous and loving them with everything you have is either it's it or it's a setup for the next thing.
I love that, man. Like, one of the things that came up for me as you were talking was something that Wayne Dyer said, or I think he was quoting someone else in an interview with Oprah, and he said, I just want God's view. Mm-hmm. And when you have that point of view, I think it's similar to what you're talking about, let go, let God, with that whole concept, mm-hmm. in one of your earlier videos. And it's mm-hmm. that the whole thing of he can see if it's him or her, whatever it is, that the being or the energy can see how all the pieces of the puzzle are put together, but we can't because we're in it, you know? You're like, can't. It just doesn't make sense to you when you're actually in the game. But hindsight is 20/20, as we always say, you know? So it makes a lot of sense. So just to wrap up with the final few questions, is there anything different you would tell the 18-year-old Preston?
I would tell him to make more mistakes, to go further than is comfortable. I tell him to play harder, to enjoy every single moment of the journey, and to let go of the idea that he needs to get it right for his parents or for society. That is all BS.
I hope that everyone who's listening right now, even if you're not 18, like it applies at any time, you know, like just pushing the boundaries and seeing what else is possible, because in the end, that's where your regrets come from. It's if I took that extra step, if I stayed in it that extra day, you know, if I spent that $500, what would have happened? So the second thing is, if you were about to leave this planet, let's say tomorrow, and you had a microphone and the whole world could hear you, what's the one thing that you'd want to say, the one message you want people to hear?
I think I would remind them that there's only one of us here. That the truth is that we're all in this together. And that includes the birds, the trees, the ocean, the fish, the animals. We're all in it together. It's only one planet. God can't separate itself, but it always says yes. And so let's start saying yes to our interdependence. Let's start saying yes to the love that is on our hearts. Let's start saying yes to all the things that connect us and play with what it looks like to be in harmony as a culture, as a society.
There's a quote I read by someone, I can't remember his name, but he said something so profound that's in line with what you're saying. And it's, we're all walking each other home.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Same journey. Yeah. So just, you know, try and help people with, everyone's on a different journey for a different reason, but mm-hmm. then they're there to take the lessons, give it to someone else in hopes mm-hmm. it increases their vibration. So they're able to live differently, sharpen their perspective and improve the way they go about the next day or the next hour or the next minute of their life. So I love that you're doing that. And just to wrap up with the last question is, you've lived a long, healthy life, and you've done everything you could possibly do. What's the legacy you want to leave behind?
I think that I want to be a part of the conversation when they look back 100, 200, 300 years from now and say, wow, we were on the edge of extinction. And there were some people who were so committed, so dedicated, so consistent, so persistent in their message that it helped us all see who and what we really were. And we turned the whole thing around. And because of that, we have a planet. Because of that, we have air. Because of that, we have love. That's the legacy I want to be a part of.
And you're doing everything you possibly can to make it happen at the moment. So thank you so much for taking the time to share your wisdom, your journey, your insights. What's the best place for people to follow you on your journey and find out what you're doing?
At Preston Smiles on Instagram or YouTube or at PrestonSmiles.com, and anything there you'll find me.
Amazing, bro. I think we only got through half the stuff. There's probably so much more we could dig deep into. So I appreciate your time and look forward to the next one.
100%, brother.